بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Today inshallah we will discuss first about the nominal sentence which we had already covered before. And thereafter, we will introduce to you some verbs. Because that's how we'll understand the verbal sentence. So to begin with, the nominal sentence in the Arabic language, there are two kinds of sentences. In the Arabic language, there are two kinds of sentences. So the first sentence is called Al-Jumla Al-Ismiya. And the second type of sentence is called Al-Jumla Al-Fi'liya. Okay. So what is the meaning of Jumla? Jumla means a sentence. So if it is a nominal sentence, we'll say Jumla Al-Ismiya. And if it is a verbal sentence, we'll say Al-Jumla to Al-Fi'liyyatu. So the main thing, what is the difference between Al-Jumla Al-Ismiyya and Jumla Al-Fi'liyya? Okay, any sentence that begins with a noun is called Jumla Al-Ismiyya. Any sentence that begins with a verb is called Jumla Al-Fi'liyya. So the one which begins with a noun is called nominal sentence. And the one which begins with a verb is called verbal sentence. So, to give you an example of al-jumla al-ismiya, we have Zaydun Alimun. Zayd ismun, Alimun ismun. Zaydun Alimun. How do you know it's a nominal sentence? Because it begins with a noun. Zaydun alimun, Fatima alimatun. Fatima is learned. Al-waladu zakiyun. What is the meaning of al-waladu zakiyun? Yes, the boy is intelligent. Al-waladu, how do you know it's ismun? A noun? Because it begins with alif lam at the beginning and no tanween at the end. So this is the sign that it is a noun. What about this boy? It is zakiyun. So you say zakiyun. Now this is the structure of a nominal sentence. The first part of a nominal sentence, definite. It has alif lam at the beginning. The second part of a nominal sentence, indefinite. So, the boy is intelligent. Very clear, it's a nominal sentence.
The Naqam is Zaydun Alimun and not Zaydu Alimun.
Okay, this is Zaydun Alimun. Now remember, when you have the name of a person, then automatically, it is not like saying, you know, when I give you a word like Baytun. When you translate Baytun, it's a house. So when it's Zaydun, you don't say a Zayd. Zayd is the name of a person, it's a proper noun. So that's why it has tanween at the end. Like Muhammadun, Hamidun, Aliyun. So this is names. So normally we would say Alimun, a learned person. So Alimun is indefinite. But these are names, when you have a name of a person, so you don't need to put alif lam, you don't have to say az-zaydu. Because zayd is already a proper noun. Okay, good question. So therefore the example of al-bintu. Al-bintu. Because if I just say bintun, a girl, a daughter. But when I say al-bintu, it becomes the girl. What about the girl? Jamilatun. So Jamila means beautiful. So what you have to remember, the structure of a nominal sentence, the first part, the subject is always definite. How do you know it's definite? Yes, walad has alif lam in the beginning, al-bintu has alif lam in the beginning. But Zayd is already definite, it's the name of a person. You don't have to say az-Zaydu. So Zaydun, subject, alimun, predicate. So these are all al-jumla al-ismiyah. Okay, so just like in English, a normal sentence in Arabic has two parts. Subject, al-mubtada'u, and predicate, al-khabaru. So mubtada and khabaru. And the other part which says something about it is called khabarun. So remember the names. Al-mubtada'u, al-khabaru. Okay, so if I ask you, does first part of a nominal sentence, what is it called? Yes, remember that. Al-mubtada. The second part of a nominal sentence, what is it called?
Al-khabaru.
This is called al-khabaru. So al-mubtada meaning the subject. And what gives you information about the subject is called al-khabaru, is called predicate. So this is why it's giving you these examples here, and you even have it here. Usually the subject of a nominal sentence is a definite noun, either a proper noun like Zayd and Fatima. Like if I say to you, Fatimatu alimatun. Okay? Now here we will come to certain words that don't take the mean at the end. And this is a word like Fatima. We will discuss that. But for now, just remember, Zaydun, Al-Waladu, Al-Bintu, Fatimatu, all these are the subject of the nominal sentence. Both the subject and the predicate are marfu'un. And what is marfu'un? It will have one dhamma or tanween. This is a very important definition. One dhamma, waladu, or tanween. So all of this, both the subject and the predicate, are, the word is marfu'un. What is marfu'un?
Nominative.
So, and really, yeah, nominative means simply it ends with a dhamma or a tanween. Tanween means a double dhamma. So that's nominative. So, al-jumla al-ismiyatu is that sentence which begins with a noun. Okay, al-jumla al-ismiyah. The first part of al-jumla al-ismiyah, that is the nominal sentence, is called subject. The second part is called predicate. In Arabic we say al-mubtada al-khabaru. The rule is, the subject of a nominal sentence is marfu'un. The predicate of a jumla ismiyah is marfu'un. Meaning both the subject and the predicate marfu'un. That is the rule. So all of these sentences, as you are reading them, subject, nominative, predicate, nominative. Now if you go to the next page, put the following nouns into the respective cases. First as indefinite, then as definite nouns, and then change them into feminine nouns and do the likewise. So here you have example of marfu'un, mansubun, and majrurun. Now you can do that because if you take the first word, muslimun, you've understood already. Muslimun, marfu'un. But I want to make muslimun mansub, that is, I'm gonna make it accusative. And when it's accusative, it will end with a fatha or fathatain. Tanween, two fatha. So Muslimun will become Musliman. And if I want to make it majrur, majrur means genitive, then it will end with a kasra or kasratain. Tanween. So Muslimun marfu'un, Musliman mansubun, Muslimin majrurun. So these are the three cases. So any word that you have It's either going to be marfu'un, the case, either going to be mansubun, or it's either going to be majrurun. So these are the three cases. Okay? So, first is just remember that any word in the language is going to be in one of three cases. So the case could be either marfu'un, it either could be mansubun, or it either could be majrurun. So for example, if I were to make Zaydun mansubun, then how would you read it?
Zaydun
will become
Zaydan.
Zaydan. And if I were to make it majrurun, it will become
Zaydin.
If I were to make Al-Waladu mansubun, it will become Al-Walada. If I want to make it majrurun, it will become Al-Waladi. So Waladun, Waladan, Waladin. In any word like that. Jamilatun, Jamilatan, Jamilatin. So just remember, the word will be in any one of these cases. For now, we've learned that if a word is subject, then it will have to always remain marfu'. You cannot say al-walada zakiyan, never. You cannot say al-waladi zakiyin. So it has to be marfu'. So this is the first part of understanding the use of the nouns in a nominative case. Any noun which is subject of a nominal sentence, marfu'un. Okay? Predicate of a nominal sentence, marfu'un. So now I would like you will need to do the rest and you will complete it. We'll just give you the example of feminine, muslimatan, muslimatan, muslimatin. So you have muslimatun, muslimatan, muslimatin. All the other days, ta marbuta at the end. Sadiqun, sadiqan, sadiqin, and sadiqatun, sadiqatan, sadiqatin. You will need to complete the rest. When you come to the bottom half, al-muslimu, because of alif lam. You cannot say al-muslimun. Al-muslimu, al-muslima, al-muslimi. Al-muslimatu, al-muslimata, al-muslimati. Okay, so these are the three cases. And you could do the rest with the other words. As-sadiqu, as-sadiqa, as-sadiqi. And then we explained already the sun letters and the moon letters. So therefore, as-sadiqu, the lam is written, but the lam is not pronounced. Why? Because it is sun letter. And the same thing. You can continue doing the rest, and we'll check that later. For now, if you come back to your book, and what we have covered thus far, al-hammamu, al-ghurfatu, on page 28, al-hammamu. You've understood why it's al-hammamu, and you've understood why it has alif lam. So if it has alif lam at the beginning, then it is?
Definite.
And al-ghurfatu, it has alif lam at the beginning, so we say it is?
Definite.
Okay, so we understood that. Now when we changing something that is marfu'un and we want to make it majrurun, so how are you going to make al-baytu majrurun?
Al-bayti.
Yes, al-bayti. How are you going to make al-masjidu majrurun?
Al-masjidi.
So now you've understood. That you have a table. And all of these words, it's either going to be marfu'un, mansubun or majrurun. So now you got the example of al-baytu. Yes? Al-bayta. And al-bayti. So al-baytu, al-bayta, al-bayti. Take the next one. Al-masjidu. Yes? Change it to majrur.
Al-masjidi.
Masjid. Masjid.
Al-masjidu marfu'un, al-masjidu mansubun, al-masjidi majrurun. The next one, al-maktabu. Al-maktabu, al-maktaba, al-maktabi. As-sariru, as-sarira, as-sariri. Now, just like how we learned that a noun is marfu'un when it is subject of a nominal sentence, when it is khabar of a nominal sentence. But here we are learning that a noun is majrurun if it is preceded by preposition. And these are the preposition. Fil bayti. So now you know why it's bayti. Okay? You know why? Because of the preposition. So therefore you cannot say fil bayta, you cannot say fil baytu. Is that clear? So fil masjidi, ala al maktabi, ala al sariri. Any questions? Main thing is to know why it has a kasra. Okay, is that clear? It has a kasra because it is preceded by fi, ala, and fi and ala are prepositions. Harf jarri. Aina Muhammadun? هو في الغرفة وأين ياسر هو في الحمام وأين آمنة هي في المطبخ أين الكتاب هو على المكتب وأين الساعة هي على السرير. So what we have learned is the use of هو and here. So هو is a substitute of the noun. So now using these are called pronouns, nominative personal pronouns. Like Muhammadun is a noun, but instead of saying Muhammadun fil ghurfati, I say huwa fil ghurfati. So huwa means he is in the room. But if I'm asking about a book, ayna al-kitabu? Ayna al-kitabu? Where is the book? Then, so if I say al-kitabu ala al-maktabi, the book is on the table, but here it is saying huwa ala al-maktabi. When you translate it as it is on the table. So huwa is used to point to a masculine, and it could be a person, and if it is an object, you can also use huwa. But when you translate it as it, if you are pointing to an object. Okay, if you're referring to an object. So this is that rule that we have learned, and that rule is found, the rule is explained to you in your book on page 35. In this lesson, we have also learned the two pronouns, huwa, he, it. He or she, it. In Arabic, all nouns are either masculine or feminine. A masculine noun is referred to by the pronoun huwa when it denotes a human being and an animal or a thing. That is important. A masculine noun is referred to by the pronoun huwa, whether it denotes a human being, an animal, or a thing. So if I say to you, Ayna al-waladu? Where is the boy? Huwa fil masjidi? He is in the masjid. If I say to you, Ayna al-kitabu? Huwa ala al-maktabi? Where is the book? So when I translate, I don't say he, I'm using huwa, but translate as it is on the table. Okay, so this is two pronouns that were introduced to you. And you had to answer the following questions. Aina al-kitabu, aina Muhammadun, aina sa'a, aina yasirun, aina amina. A amina fil ghurfati, is amina in the room? Ayasir in fil matbakhi. What is the meaning of matbakh?
Kitchen.
He is Yasir in the kitchen. Man fil ghurfati.
Who is in the
room? Woman fil hammami. And who is in the bathroom? Mada ala al maktabi. What is on the table? Mada ala al sariri. And what is on the bed? So you have to answer these questions. Ajib an al as'ila. Okay, mashallah, you all have done it. Mashallah, very good. Yes, if we go to the next page, we also covered. Now, if you are reading it, you will have to read it because you've understood the rule. So now, because you've understood al-madrasatu is marfu'un, so automatically you read it as madrasatu. Then you read fil madrasati, fil bayti, البيت الغرفة الحمام في الحمام في المطبخ على المكتب على المكتب على الكرسي السرير على الكتاب في المسجد. Any questions there? Understood the rule. So simply because it's preceded by a preposition, that is why the nouns now become مجرور. So we just need to remember that any word in the Arabic language is either going to be marfu'un, mansubun, or majrurun. You just need to know when is it marfu', when is going to be mansubun, when is going to be majrurun. Okay? So right now we've covered marfu'un. I've explained to you what is mansubun, but the examples will come shortly. Iqra waktub, read and write. Yes, read after me. At-talibu fil jami'ati.
At-talibu fil jami'ati.
الرجل في المسجد أين التاجر هو في الدكان Where is the businessman? He is in the shop. القلم على المكتب أين زينب Now زينب is a proper noun but it doesn't end with تنوين. Okay, so some proper nouns don't end with تنوين. زيدون ends with تنوين. So this is, lesson will come as we go along. Just remember, so Zain, you don't say Zainabun. Okay. Aina Zainabu. Hiya fil ghurfati.
She is in the room.
Aina al-waraku.
Huwa
ala
al-maktabi.
What is the meaning of warak? Where is the paper? It is on the table. Aina al-mudarrisu. هو في الفصل أين ياسر هو في المرحاض What is مرحاض Toilet الشمس والقمر في السماء The sun and the moon are in the sky So الشمس the sun و means in So this و is It is a harf particle, but it is not a preposition, conjunction. So therefore, it still remains nominative. Okay, so remember the wa, waw, is harf ataf, conjunction. It means and, the sun and the moon are in the sama. So both ashamsu wal kamru is marfu'in. Man fil fasli. Who is in the room? Fasli means like classroom. Who is in the classroom? So you needed to read and write. Ikra, read and waktub, write. Ta'ammal ma yali. Consider the following. Okay. Muhammadun. خالد حامد ياسر عمار سعيد علي عباس You got all the names? We have learned that the tanween is the indefinite article. Example, baytun, you say a house. The rule does not apply to proper nouns. So hamidun is just hamid. And you don't say a hamid. All these words. It's a proper noun. Feminine proper nouns have no tanween. That is the rule. Feminine proper nouns don't take tanween. So therefore, when you are reading the following, you don't say Aminatun. Amina, Zainabu, Fatima, Maryamu, Aisha, Khadija, Safiya, Ruqayya. Okay. So you have Zainab, Ruqayya, Fatima. These are the names of the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, brother.
So you know on page 30, number 5 at the bottom.
Page 30, number 5.
So when you say Aina Zainab, although Zayas and Haruf Shamsi, you won't join it, would you? Just separate, you say.
Haruf, I mean the Haruf. Haruf is a plural of Haruf. When you speak about the sun letters means it has to be preceded by a lam. So Zainab is just the name. So all proper nouns don't need alif lam in the beginning. So the function of alif lam is to change a word that is indefinite to definite. We say from nakira to ma'arifa. But because Zainab is already a proper noun, so it doesn't take alif lam in the beginning. So you never say az-Zainabu. All these words. Fatima, Maryam, okay? Read and write each of the following words. Iqra' waktub ma'adabti al-akhir al-kalimat. So now that you've understood the rule, it'll be easy for you to follow. So when you are reading it, you'll read. Yes. Read.
Hamidun.
Zainabu. Amina. Ammarun. Sa'idun.
Fatima.
Maryamu. Aliyun. خالد عباس عائشة محمد صفية. So you don't say صفية, okay? صفية خدي خديجة. Okay, on page 32. البيت من البيت المسجد
المسجد
إلى المسجد
إلى المسجد
المدرس